All right. Good morning, everyone. It's officially 11 o'clock, so I think we're going to go ahead and get started. Hey, welcome. Welcome to the first session of DrupalCon New Orleans 2016. And we're here for SCORE, Superior Digital Experiences with MLS. And I'd like to first throw the mic to Brian to introduce himself.
Hello, I am Brian Avnar, Director of Engineering at Major League Soccer.
And hey, I'm Stephen Merrill. I'm the Director of Phase2's DevOps Engineering Practice. So to start off, how many people here know of Major League Soccer? All right, how many people here have been to a Major League Soccer game or watched one?
Nice.
All right, so
Yeah.
So I guess maybe then I'll go on. How many people have been to an MLS game? So maybe we have some avids here. Like, this is a pretty good distribution of fans. Hey. Red Bulls, yes. I have to, you know what, I have to actually admit, this is maybe a bit of a shameful thing. I've lived in New York City for 8 years, and the first time I ever went to Yankee Stadium was to go to a New York City football club game, not to go to a Yankees game. Yeah, I know. Yeah. All right, cool. So, this session is SCORE, Superior Digital Experiences. And what we really want to talk about is just sort of some work that we have been doing together over the past year. So to start out with, Brian's going to give you some information about the league and kind of about the group that he works with inside of the league specifically.
Yeah, so real top level on the state of the league. We've got 20 teams with plans to expand to 24 by 2020. All along the way, we're adding state-of-the-art soccer-specific stadiums around the U.S. And it's noteworthy that our average stadium attendance actually exceeds NHL and NBA. We're expanding our reach in the U.S. and around the world with great new TV distribution deals. And one of the really interesting aspects of our league is that our fan base is very young and multicultural and very digital hungry. A good lion's share of our traffic is actually not coming from desktop websites. So we're really focused on building out our digital products, whether they be web, mobile app, tablet, CTV, whatever it may be, and the services that power them is very important to us. So in terms of our fan base, we really bucket them into two categories. We've got avids and casuals. We define avids as fans that are regularly watching and attending MLS matches. We've got these fans are also regularly consuming soccer-related content, and they're regularly visiting our properties, whether they be the league site, MLSsoccer.com, the individual club sites, or any other soccer-specific sites. Our casuals we define as those that are watching and attending matches less frequently, occasionally, basically. And one of our objectives is to grow both, so convert non-casuals to casuals and also get casuals to become more avid. This is like our operating principles. In terms of our ecosystem, we've got 20 club sites. Each club has a website and one league site, all running on Drupal 7 in a multi-tenanted environment, so one Drupal instance, many sites. Stephen will talk more about that. We've got mobile apps, iOS and Android, for phone and for tablet. We've got connected television devices, Roku, Chromecast, and Apple TV. And then we've got services which power everything, a content API. We've a series of microservices that are powering our video and stats ingestion. So our video and stats comes from third-party providers, and we have a series of services which pull this information and process them through a pipeline, and then they eventually end up in our Drupal CMS. And all of this is running within AWS.
All right. So a lot of what we want to talk about is that, as we'll say, we've actually been working together for a while. But for the year from March of 2015 to March of 2016, MLS Digital and Phase 2 have worked quite closely together on a pretty large project that we want to tell you about. And it actually bridges a lot of different areas, from infrastructure and DevOps to the actual platform itself, to even some kind of management and delegation challenges that were there.
So we had one goal in 2015, and that was really to modernize and stabilize the MLS web platform, both the back end and the front end. And this really meant, in practicality, successfully migrating 21 sites from our colo and Drupal 6 to AWS and Drupal 7. So a lot of things were happening at once, and also, part of this is also a redesign. So we were accomplishing a lot at once.
Yeah, so, and obviously, you know, as Brian said, migrating 21 different sites with 21 different sets of stakeholders required a large multidisciplinary team. So in terms of the folks who worked together to accomplish the goals of this migration and stabilization from about March of 2015 to March of 2016, I work for Phase 2, obviously. Phase 2 was founded in 2001. We have major offices in DC, New York, San Francisco, and Portland. And then we also have a bunch of distributed folks throughout North America. So we also have a very remote-friendly culture as well. You are at DrupalCon. You've probably heard of us in terms of some of the large Drupal sites, Drupal contributions that we've made, things like Atrium, our collaboration-focused distro and product. And so we are very committed to open source technology. We do so much work in the open source space, and we use open technology to help our clients succeed. And, you know, I say you're at DrupalCon, you know of us as a Drupal shop, but we're always moving beyond that. Like, as you'll see, quite a bit of the work that we're talking about with Brian is about infrastructure and scaling and DevOps. We also have a rapidly expanding experience team of content strategists, UX and UI folks. So, in addition to doing large Drupal platform builds, we're always expanding kind of our capabilities around the edges. So, in terms of Phase 2 and MLS, we've actually worked together for a while. We've been working together for a little over 3 years at this point. Brian had mentioned that there was a legacy Drupal 6 site and platform and a new Drupal 7 one. We actually helped to build out the Drupal 7 platform. Originally, the Drupal 7 platform was going to be used for a series of Mexican soccer leagues. There is a property called Medio Tiempo, which actually kind of reports on soccer news in Latin America. And we originally built out the D7 platform to be the home for that, to actually just be home for soccer news and not necessarily for the league itself. Over time, though, as the D6 platform stagnated, and we'll talk about some of the challenges with the D6 platform, we said, well, let's actually just use what we've built here and make it the home for the club sites and the league site. As I said, in March 2015, we actually kicked off this effort to do the migration to what we called MP7, in other words, the Drupal 7 platform, and to move into AWS.
So a bit on the team for 2015. We had, in terms of capabilities and practices, we had we had Drupal developers, we had full stack JavaScript developers that were developing in React, Backbone, Node.js, and Go. We had DevOps, and the process we followed was Scrumbon, which, for those that don't know, it's kind of like the best of both worlds from the Scrum and the Kanban methodology. We picked this specifically because we felt it really maximized our development velocity and our ability to be responsive to business needs. And 2015 also marked the beginning of a plan to centralize our development team. And what this means is that we were moving from separate teams, one for Drupal platform development and another, the other for other technologies, and we're trying to start to consolidate. We started with DevOps because the first point in consolidation is to get our deployments, our management of our stack as unified as possible. So one way to triage from the high level. And this kind of is starting our process to try to get as much centralization as possible, so everyone knows as much about the infrastructure as everyone else. So the challenges and solutions for 2015. We had an outdated UX. Originally, our sites were built for desktop viewing only. We had an adaptive site, m.site, that did not share the same functionality for the most part, different experiences. We had inflexible authoring. The authoring as it relates to how the pages would be rendered on mobile and desktop. We had wasted server capacity. So our because of our high variability in traffic, it's very spiky based on games and events, we needed to plan for the worst. So that goes to our fourth challenge, which was high fixed infrastructure costs. All the while, there's poor performance, poor performing modules, code, and you know, we all know the scalability issues that can be challenging with a Drupal site, and so we were looking to address that. And technology soup. This is more of a just the nature of the environment, which makes things hard. It's not necessarily that we kind of addressed that in 2015, but we took steps towards that, and this is going to be an ongoing challenge and that we're always addressing as we move forward. And last but not least, we had an aggressive migration. 21 sites, no downtime. Each club and the league has major tentpole events throughout the year, and we had to migrate and have no effect to the users, the fans, and the stakeholders.
All right, so now I'd like to kind of dig in one by one into these challenges that we were talking about and talk about how we kind of looked to avoid those. So the first one that Brian talked about was sort of an inflexible UI. Like when the initial Drupal 6 platform was built, there was just the desktop site. There was an actual different adaptive m.site that really had like stripped down content. So it was a very different experience. Even for a while, there was an even like lower grade mobile site too at one point, which was turned off. So the whole idea behind the D7 platforms is just kind of bake responsive in. Like in the, and so I'll talk more when we talk about how the actual Drupal site is laid out, but there was one common MP7 base theme. And that base theme had all of the responsive breakpoints already built in. So we basically said, you know, in order to make this easier and in order to make it easy to have a consistent visual theme between all the different clubs and the league, and in order to make sure that the responsive stuff worked, and this actually happened before we got there, but Hans, who worked at MLS, was the front-end lead and actually said, hey, we're going to make an MP7 theme that just works at the breakpoints that we want. And so, you know, we had to make sure that all new features were designed for that, but then kind of out of the box, we got to the point where all of the clubs just have a sub-theme off of the MP7 theme, and as a result, you know, the colors change for each club, the logos change for each club, but that way you're not reinventing the wheel, right? You've got this theme that you know works. There was actually also a kind of internal test club called Digital FC that we used as like the testing ground for this as a way to have a club. But yeah, this way, like kind of out of the box, you had a theme that was responsive, that worked in multiple breakpoints. So you didn't need an M dot, you didn't need like a different tablet site. You just had the same content that was being served up and then the layout optimized for all three of the breakpoints that you worked at. Another big one was editorial flexibility. So the way that we built this was designed to give editors the maximum amount of flexibility while still making sure that they didn't do anything that would jeopardize the responsive nature of the sites, right? As Brian mentioned, you know, the majority of MLS's traffic does not come from desktop browsers at this point. So it is very important that everything that is available, you know, the experience is appropriate no matter what device you happen to be viewing it on. So yeah, like all the building blocks that we put together, the grid of articles on a section landing page, the videos lists, all these things, we had to make sure that they were, you know, building blocks that editors could go in and put content into, and that there wasn't a way to like break out and make something that wasn't gonna work in a responsive fashion. You know, and another big thing about MLS's platform, the Drupal 6 platform was pretty monolithic. Like, everything revolved around Drupal. But as Brian said, MLS has got a ton of different services now. And really, the MLS tech team builds a lot of the stuff that is more real-time, that deals with things like streaming stats, things that you want to have live updates for, using Node.js. And so really, you know, Drupal is the CMS. It is the core linchpin of where all the content is created and where it's distributed. But again, you know, this build was started probably like 4 years ago, and so Drupal 8 was still really, really in early stages. So MLS has a content API that uses Drupal's database, but is itself a Node app, for example. Or there is a live match center experience where avid fans can go and keep track of stuff that's going on during a game. And so that stuff, you know, that itself is written in Node. It uses WebSockets so that you can get updates on everything as it happens using WebSockets. But still, everything goes through Drupal as the CMS. Like, Drupal is the canonical place where editors will make articles, or they will see that the video system has delivered a video, write up some content around it, and then publish it. So Drupal's kind of the, you know, the digital hub in all of this, and then it feeds out into the connected TV platforms via the API. It's really kind of the gatekeeper. So some of the other specific tools, in addition to just being able to work with all of these content entities that are being fed in through their pipeline, also includes just, you know, the ability to do really nice image cropping. Because of the responsive nature, you want to make sure that if you have an image that it looks good in all the different breakpoints that you're going to put in the site. And certainly something that MLS is perhaps looking forward to in the future might be to look at taking advantage of some of the better editorial UI in Drupal 8. Like, I think in some cases, you know, editors would like to be able to use the quick edit feature, for example, and just be able to change a field or two. Certainly there's pros and cons to that, but something that's, you know, maybe being thought of for down the road. So Brian mentioned spiky traffic. I think MLS definitely gets very, very spiky traffic. So there are big traffic spikes whenever big events happen, when news about players comes out, honestly, when games happen. You know, when games are going on, usually the league site itself, as well as the club sites for the games that are going on, get a big influx of traffic. The league site itself represents about half the traffic on the platform. So at any given time, like, that's one that will be getting a good majority of the traffic. And so as a result, this actually, MLS is a great candidate for auto-scaling. So this also ties into the problem that Brian was talking about of having high infrastructure costs. So when we got to MLS, I really like this term that Brian used, they kind of had one foot in the cloud, right? Their Drupal 6 platform was in rack space on physical servers, you know, no real burstable capacity. Because again, when the Drupal 6 platform was started, Rackspace was a great option. And certainly, you know, they offer 24/7 support. There are some really nice perks to using them. So Drupal was over in Rackspace, and then the new services that MLS was building, the content API, the stats ingestion pipeline, all these things were being deployed to Amazon Web Services. So yeah, Drupal was running in this big fixed set of servers that were configured and set up so they could handle the high end of that spiky traffic amount, because obviously, like, with Rackspace, they can't, like, really rack servers for you quickly. If you say, oh man, we're, you know, every team in the league is going to play next Sunday, could you have us servers in a week, they might be like, oh, that'll be a lot of money to get that set up. You know, they're not exactly as agile as you might like them to be in that case. And for the physical infrastructure in Rackspace, you also had things like redundant firewalls, redundant F5 load balancers, NetApp physical storage servers to handle the files directory. So basically, it was a large infrastructure that really had a fixed amount of capacity in it. So that really led to paying for all this capacity even when there wasn't a game going on, or even worse, when the season wasn't going on. Certainly, MLSsoccer.com is a great hub for news, but you have, you know, less visits to the club sites when it's the off-season. So, you know, this was a big driver for moving to AWS, to be able to have everything in a single scalable cloud infrastructure. You know, one of the big benefits is auto-scale instances, and we'll talk about that in a second, but honestly, you know, there are a lot of different providers these days that will give you Linux servers at the click of a button, right? And certainly they're great for some purposes, but, like, yeah, you could go to DigitalOcean, you could go to Linode, you could go to these places and get Linux servers that you scale up and down. The real operational benefits to your business through using something like AWS come in their ancillary services. Like, how many people here manage MySQL servers on your own? Okay, not a ton, which, I mean, I certainly don't want to. And so you have things like Amazon RDS, right? So Amazon is not just, we'll give you a bunch of disks, we'll give you a bunch of instances. They also have things like Amazon RDS, which will save your bacon. I have had Amazon RDS save me pretty handily because they will just handle like point-in-time restores. I mean, I know how to do that in a physical data center, but to just have Amazon manage it and some, you know, somebody accidentally deletes 500 articles, you can restore to an hour ago. You know, that's all just built in. So in addition to being a great platform for auto-scaling and running Linux instances, there are these other things that offer you a huge cost and time reduction to be able to run your business, like Amazon RDS, Amazon ElastiCache, Amazon S3 to store your files in. All right, so auto-scaling. How many people have ever like sat on the phone and just looked at a server graph when something was going on and been really stressed out about it? Okay, that's not a place that you want to be, right? So auto-scaling has some awesome technical benefits, but I think the number one benefit to auto-scaling done well is reducing stress. Like we actually did get to the point where we could come in on a Monday morning and look at our monitoring system and say, oh, hey, look, we had some games on Sunday. We auto-scaled up to 5 instances, and then at like 10 o'clock at night, the traffic had dropped off and we were back down to 2 instances. So I really think that like the peace of mind for you, for your engineers, for your ops team, is one of the biggest reasons to go to auto-scaling. Another benefit, even before we talk about kind of the scaling part of it, is the automatic healing. If you have 2 servers, at least, in an auto-scaling group, and one of them just dies for whatever reason, AWS will bring it back up. So, you know, I mean, certainly stuff happens in data centers. You know, you might get a notice that your host is going to go away where one of these servers is running. Once you get to the point that you have your setup so that you can do auto-scaling, it is a fantastic way to also make your infrastructure self-healing. So then the reason that most people use it, though, is for the performance, the fact that you can scale up and down. You can automatically scale based on certain criteria, and that's mostly what we did at MLS. We would say based on a certain CPU threshold, if the average goes over this amount, add a new instance into the pool. For Drupal sites, CPU is a pretty good indicator, but you can actually use anything that Amazon can monitor. Another great thing, though, is that you can also do manual scaling, right? Like if you know we have 5 games going on with the 5 biggest teams in the league, you could also be like, let's just scale up to 6 ahead of time, pay Amazon an extra $30 this month, and then scale it back down in 4 hours. So again, that kind of goes back to the peace of mind. You can preemptively and proactively scale in addition to doing it in response to monitoring events. And of course, this all leads to cost benefits. If you're only running like 2 small instances and then you can burst up to say 6 small instances when you need it, you're gonna pay a lot less on average. So a way that people like to use this is to talk about cattle and not pets, that you should build cattle and not pets. And the reason behind this is that it is a shift in how you think. How many people here have ever had a pet that you really loved and you lavished attention on? Okay, if you're going to use auto-scaling, you don't want your servers to be pets because of that connection. Like you have a server that's a pet, probably has a name, you're really attached to it. If it went away, you'd be really sad. Like your primary database server is probably a pet, and that's okay. Like you don't want that to go away. But your web servers should be cattle, right? They should be ready to be shipped off for processing when their time has come. But this is a real term that's used. I didn't make this up. But if you ever read something about cattle, not pet, basically the idea is that it's a mind shift, that for at least like the application servers, in the case of Drupal, like the servers where your LAMP stack or LEMP stack is running, you have to know that they're ephemeral, right? Because the thing about auto-scaling is that at any time a new instance could come up, or an instance that came up in response to a traffic spike could just go away. So it really does change how you have to think about like doing your builds. So when we got to MLS, because they were looking at moving to AWS, had already kind of gotten to a point where they had an auto-scaling setup, but it was not necessarily working all that well. One of the big problems with the setup that was there was that it would take a new Amazon instance from completely scratch, like nothing installed on it, and install everything using its config manager, and then put the build of Drupal on there, and then at that point you'd be ready to go. The problem was that sometimes under load, it would take more than like 5 minutes to do that. And if you really need new traffic, you know, right now, you need new servers to handle that, that just, you know, that isn't enough time. So Phase2 came in and said, hey, let's move to a fat build where we build in all the software, the Drupal code itself, and we do that every time that we have a build, you know, ready to go to master. And that way, an AMI can come up even if everything else is down. Like if the config management server is down, doesn't matter. We have an AMI that has all our dependencies. If we can't get access to our Drupal source code repo, doesn't matter, because we've already built it into the AMI. Basically, if anything else is down or there's some kind of problem, it won't matter, and you'll be able to access it. So I am actually giving a talk tomorrow that is about immutable infrastructure and how you can run Drupal using Amazon autoscaling or using Docker and a scheduler. So if you'd like to see some more about that, I'm presenting tomorrow. So here's some examples of what we're looking at. We turned autoscaling on for MLS. The top line on this graph is the load average. So that's basically the number of processes that are running at any given time. And the bottom line is the number of autoscaling instances. So you can see that the bottom line for the number of autoscaling instances is 2, and it sometimes ticks up to 4 when there's traffic. You can see that actually, like, for the first couple days in this graph, there's basically an average of 2 autoscaling instances. Then for a little while, it jumps up to needing 3 to handle the traffic. Then it goes back down. At a couple points, those are probably weekends when there's, like, games going on, it has to go up to 4 instances. But again, this all just happens automatically. We could come in on a Monday morning and say, oh, cool, you know, we went up to 4. The average on this graph, it's kind of hard to see, but is like 2.3. So this means that, you know, MLS on average is paying for like 2.3 instances and not 4 of them, which is what they had before. Then we later did some other performance tweaks, and we got it to the point where you can maybe guess where the performance tweaks rolled out, because the number of instances just goes to 2. And so generally, even for some pretty spiky traffic, like that's a whole week at the end of the graph, we could handle it with just 2. So this is some really great peace of mind. All right, poor performance. How many people have ever had an editor come to you and say, Drupal is dogging. It is so slow when I hit submit on this page? Okay. It's a thing that happens sometimes, right? And we certainly had that too. You know, we got to the point where our performance was pretty good for visitors to the site, but editors had some problems. And I will say another thing that MLS toyed with, and I say this just kind of as a cautionary tale, at one point, and you can still read the blog post about this, MLS was actually serving traffic out of 2 different regions. They said, hey, let's serve stuff out of Virginia and out of Oregon. That eventually ended up having some problems just mainly due to caches, right? Like Drupal's full of caches, and then if you have like a whole setup over here in Oregon and a whole setup over here in Virginia, so that actually resulted in some extra like cache clearing stuff being put into the code base, which later came back to cause some of this slow performance. So we actually found one case where like when an editor hit save, it was clearing all of Drupal's caches 3 times. It was taking like 10 seconds, and we managed to get that out of there. And we actually, at the time when we came in, some Drupal pages were taking more than a second to load, which we didn't like, and we managed to track that down. So a couple of the quick things that we did when we first started working with MLS is we just wanted to say, hey, are we using the right AWS instances? MLS was using M4 instance types, which are kind of a good balance of memory and network and CPU. Drupal loves CPU in general, though, so we said, hey, let's use the CPU optimized, the C4 class of instances. Combining that and upgrading to PHP 5.5 from 5.3 actually got a 40% increase in performance with a slightly lower hosting bill, because the C instances are just a little bit cheaper. And we also did a couple things like ripped out one of the 4 caching layers that was there, because it really wasn't helping out. So this is really just to say that, you know, it's possible just by like upgrading a PHP version, then you could get a pretty decent increase in performance for your platform. So don't count that out. We also did a lot of load testing and using application monitoring tools. We had at one point enabled a thing that was trying to do DB read-write splits. Was actually hurting more than it was helping. We looked at increasing the size of their memcache pool and killing off some of that legacy code that I was talking about. And so at one point we were able to reduce the instance sizes by half and also decrease the page render times by a pretty big amount. So here's actually some stuff that Brian put together for MLS management to talk about the work that we did.
So this chart is from our application monitoring tool, New Relic. And it kind of summarizes our efforts towards optimization and performance increase. So this arrow here represents when you actually installed a monitoring tool. We did not have one that monitored actual real-time application performance, like how the health of the server is doing at any moment, currently, in the past. So once we installed that, we had great visibility into how poorly our application was performing, but specifically what was slow inside of your app. During this time period, we were doing our analysis. These red bands represent degraded server performance that may or may not correlate to UX experience. So these red bands are indicators that something's wrong. And as you can see, we really were hovering between like 1 to 2 seconds, basically. So at the end of this, during this process, we were doing our analysis, and we came up with at the end here with three root causes. These root causes can kind of be summed up as follows. We had AWS cloud caching configuration that was suboptimal. We had, and that actually just equated to our memcache settings, basically. And in Amazon, that's ElastiCache. We saw that there was inefficient database access happening through our application database libraries. And third was there was a handful of top destination sites that were responsible for the overall slowdown of the entire site. And so these were pages that were frequently accessed, things like our schedule page or things like our stats page. So by addressing and focusing and prioritizing our optimization efforts towards those top worst performing pages, we ended up greatly reducing our response time. So each one of these arrows represents a build that had a fix for the aforementioned root causes. And the net is that we were at between 250 milliseconds to 500 milliseconds of server response time. That's not the greatest. You know, I've worked on sites that were much faster, but this is a fact twofold and decrease. And it was pretty pivotal in getting us into the direction that we wanted to go.
Cool. So yeah, as Brian mentioned, MLS has a lot of awesome tech going on. And as Brian mentioned, this is still something that MLS is kind of working to alleviate is the complexity. But really, I think, the biggest thing and one of the things that MLS is working on now is that you've got Drupal world over here, which is Drupal 6 and 7, PHP 5.1 or 5.5 now, using Jenkins for build, Salt for deployment, building Amazon AMIs for doing that auto-scaling. Then on the other side, you've got the services side, which are Go and Node-based. Those were already set up using Docker and using CoreOS and Fleet. So basically, one of the problems was that in order to be able to fully understand the platform, you had to know Salt and Jenkins and Team City and Docker and AMIs. There was a lot of different stuff on different sides of the stack. So although we didn't finish, getting that addressed in this year, that's something that MLS is working on quite a bit. So the biggest challenge, I think, was migration. When we got to MLS, there were actually three clubs that were already in AWS, even without auto-scaling, that were on the Drupal 7 platform, and editors were using them. Seattle actually had originally been running their own website up to this point, so they actually were the first to be migrated. And then Orlando and New York City Football Club were new to the league, so they actually were on MP7. There was not a legacy Drupal 6 site to migrate from. But figuring out how to do this migration was really quite a big project management lift. We had to talk with the stakeholders from the clubs, from the league. We ended up actually deciding that we would try to have four different groups of sites to be migrated, and that basically for each of the groups we'd get a timeline where we would do overnight migrations. Whenever a site was in migration, we would continually migrate from Drupal 6 to Drupal 7 using a migrate that was built on top of the migrate module that kicked off using Jenkins. And that way, we could continually be putting the new data into the Drupal 7 site so that editors would have the stuff that they had in their old platform in the new one, and then they would get training on how to use the new site and the new system. Another thing that we had to figure out, with this group of four different sets of migrations, was how to work around club schedules. Because certainly, you've got big games, you've got big events for each one of the clubs. So that actually took a lot of work to do in that case as well. A really huge part of this, too, was that MLS has a fairly small tech team in terms of developers. But then MLS also has a group called Digital Club Services. And really, Digital Club Services was a fantastic help, and their group, during the course of this, actually doubled in size, just because they were such an important asset. So that, they were not Drupal developers, but they were really, they knew the CMS and know the CMS inside and out. So, they were the ones who did training for the clubs. Like when we had a group of three clubs that we knew were going to migrate, we said, hey, okay, Digital Club Services is going to help you by giving you training, by showing you how to set up your, you know, your schedule page, your tickets page, all the, you know, the standard pages that clubs wanted to come in. In addition, they're also really deeply integrated into the like development team and the development workflow. So the thing is like that they kind of act as a tier one support desk. Like if an editor in Vancouver or Houston has a problem, they don't actually like go right to the developers. They will actually go to Digital Club Services and say, hey, I'm having trouble doing this thing. What should I do? And the really great thing about, like, as Brian said, of like building this centralized team inside of MLS Digital is that usually if someone has a problem, you know, an editor has a problem, that Digital Club Services is going to say one of three things. One will be, oh, here's how you do that, and then it's solved, which is great. The second one might be, oh, that's a bug. We'll help you work around that, and then we will make sure that this gets addressed as soon as possible. You know, so if it's a known issue, they might have a workaround, or then yeah, they might just say, okay, you know, that is a bug, but it's planned to be released next week or next month. So, you know, they were the ones who actually helped us to kind of figure out what were the pressing issues that editors were facing, which is important when you have 21 different like editor communities that are using this digital platform. Another big thing about this, how many people here know about Drupal multi-site? All right. And how many people have heard both good and bad things about Drupal multi-site? Yeah, it's kind of a polarizing thing, and there's good reasons for that. So MLS, the Drupal 7 platform was not originally a Drupal multi-site when we got there. And again, when we got there, there were really only three clubs on it, and the league site was in beta, but we knew that we had to like get it a little more stable before we actually flipped the switch on the league website. So we took a look at the site itself and said, you know what, this actually would make sense as a Drupal multi-site. So when you're considering Drupal multi-site, you do have to think about your audience, about what level of, you know, differentiation your different stakeholders will have in terms of like, do they need different versions of modules? Are they going to want to have very different themes? But honestly, given that MLS Digital basically runs this as a service to their clubs, right? None of the clubs have web development resources. Like, it's not like Seattle's like, I want panels 5 and context 4 and I want to do this. Like, those are the kinds of things that make Drupal multi-site hard, when it's like every site wants like a different module or different versions of contrib modules. But in the case of MLS, like MLS Digital really is a service provider to the clubs. And so we said, hey, this actually makes perfect sense as a multi-site. Because, you know, we even talked before, there's like an MP7 theme that everyone inherits from, and that makes sure that you are on brand, that your stuff works to all these responsive breakpoints that have been defined. So with that, we said, okay, we'll migrate the first couple sites. We'll do them not as a multi-site, but down the road, it's actually going to make sense to run as a multi-site. And by going to a multi-site, you got a couple things. It helps save server resources, for one. Drupal caches all of its, well, PHP caches all of the Drupal code into memory. And so if we were going to have like 21 different sites, we figured that was going to be like a gig of memory that we could otherwise get back if we used a multi-site. It also just made the deploys smaller. Like, certainly all these different themes with different node modules, folders, and things, and then different copies of the Drupal code base and the same contrib modules. If you repeat those like 21 times, you know, I think our builds were like 400 megs when we got started. And then when we rolled out a multi-site, like a build was like 30 megs. So it just really made a ton of sense. Yeah, and as I said, that is because there is no bespoke development in each club. And it really helped to like centralize future development. And another huge thing about this is that, so the MLS site platform has 20 clubs and the league, and honestly just 6 people support it. Like, there are 4 Digital Club Services folks who are tier one, who work with the editors, who work to help prioritize development, and at this point there's 2 Drupal developers that are supporting like a 21 site platform for a major sports league in America. So I think this centralization, both of the code and, as Brian said, of the teams that are working together, has really made it so that, you know, the day-to-day operations and the work on the platform itself can really just be done by 6 people, which is pretty great. So a quick overview of our our milestones. We started in March. In April, we launched the New York Red Bulls site. They were the first one to be the ones that we migrated. In July, we turned on auto-scaling. We worked from April to November to actually migrate the sites over to the MP7 platform. In October, the league, MLSsoccer.com site, launched on D7 and in AWS. There was also a huge high-traffic, high-fan-impact event that was new for 2015 called Decision Day that happened in October that the platform stood through. In December, we managed to turn off the legacy hosting provider. In January of 2016, I'm actually very happy that we, Brian and I worked together to help hire an engineer who had DevOps skills into the MLS organization. So we actually did kind of help hire our own replacement on the infrastructure and DevOps side, and we're still working with MLS on like the Drupal platform side. And then this March, we all sat in a conference room at MLS Digital's headquarters, and we had a successful launch to the 2016 season with all of the infrastructure in AWS and completely on the new MP7 platform.
So a slight step back, and just to go over the tooling that we use to accomplish a lot of the performance optimization, without which we really could not have gotten the site to perform the way it does. basically three tools: New Relic for application performance management. I've mentioned this before. I'll go a little bit more into depth about what that looks like and how it helped us. Blaze Meter for load testing. And Datadog for our infrastructure metrics. Essentially, you don't have to have these exact tools, but in my opinion, you need something that accomplishes what these tools do. So something that is able to report on how the health of your application in real time. And if you make changes to address performance, you need to test those changes with some sort of load testing tool. And then you need some kind of monitoring of your infrastructure in totality to see how it's doing with regards to things like disk reads, CPU utilization, server health. So New Relic, I'm kind of breaking this down a little bit more just because of how crucial it was in our operations. So what it is, in my opinion, is it is table stakes tooling for the modern technology team. So whether you're using New Relic or one of their or a similar APM tool, like I believe AppDynamics is another one, it's absolutely essential to understand how your site is performing at any given time, and also how your site might have not performed in the past. What it is it provides real-time end-to-end client and server metrics and performance measurement. So this is really the ability to look into everything from how your code is performing in a user's browser to how the Drupal modules are performing in the server to even how the database is responding to queries and the slow performing queries. So a good example of really like what we get out of it in terms of like a user story is we can use New Relic to show us that an article page was slow yesterday for a user in California using the Chrome browser at 9 p.m. We can also find out that the slowness of that particular user was 70% on their browser. So it was JavaScript that was slowing down that user's experience. Or the opposite. We could say, oh, well, you know, it was actually server lag that was responsible for that slowness. And that kind of visibility is crucial to really figuring out what your application problems are. I'm going to go over just some kind of things you can get out of New Relic. So what we're looking at now, out of the box, after you install New Relic, with minimal configuration, I might add, you can get a view of your entire stack. Application, server, I'm sorry, your client code. The middle tier there is the server, and on the right there, that is the repository. So that would be the Memcache instance, the EOS API, that's our API, our web service, which has our Drupal sites reliant on web services. And then on the bottom there, that's the database instance. Now, you can also drill down. And so if you expand each one of those, I can see, oh, wow, look, here's how my browser, here's how the average performance of my code is running on a browser. Here's how that relates to the server. And here's how that relates to its external web service calls or the database or the what have you. Now, this is an example of when we had a performance hit on our server. So as you can see, the middle server module is red, and that's signifying that there's a problem there. Not on the browser, not on the database, but on the server code. And that will happen wherever New Relic locates bottlenecks. Here's another view. This New Relic is also self-aware of the application that it is introspecting. So New Relic knows, oh, this is a Drupal app. Immediately, it gives you a section called Drupal with a breakdown of modules, hooks, and views. So from here, you can see, I can see what's my slowest module that's performing, or what is the slowest running module. So one is you could have a module that's called by everybody, and so therefore that will be slow. Another scenario is you might just have a module that's not called a lot, but when it's called, it is dog slow. And you can look at this with modules, hooks, and views. No configuration was done to get that. Here's an example of what the high-level metrics for our multi-site look like. So this is an aggregate of all of the clubs in the site. So we can look at our aggregate of all of our editorial instances, our admin instances, and our roll-up of our 21 sites in our production instance. And we can see the average is about 5.6 seconds on the end user experience. The average is about we're in a bad situation right now at the 1.4, so it really does work. We're about like above a second on our app server. You can also then look at individual sites within your multi-site. So here, this is the Red Bulls and the NYCFC, and I can see specifically how that code is operating with the NYCFC and the Red Bulls traffic.
All right, yeah. So in summary, just to go back and kind of what we talked about, by the end of our year, which is basically from March 2015 to March 2016, we had gotten to the point where all of MLS Digital Services were migrated fully into AWS. And this, in turn, helped to significantly lower the hosting costs, just mainly because, you know, Rackspace or any like legacy host is pretty inflexible. So both by using Amazon services that took less money, like auto-scaling in the average case, or less time to maintain, like RDS, that helped actually free up MLS to like actually build new features for their Drupal platform, or build new digital products, like build new things into the Match Center experience, into the connected TV experience. We also really helped to reduce support load. So as Brian said, like kind of a big part that was happening, not even related to technology, but still a very important part, was the growth of that centralized digital club services team and integrating them very deeply into one combined development organization. So that, you know, you've got stakeholders at MLS that are driving new feature development. You've got the digital club services group who are really kind of like tier one of supporting the editors in all 21 of the different, you know, instances of the site. And then they helped actually like drive development to say like, hey, we need this bug fixed before we migrate, or then like this club really wants this feature. And so yeah, like not every change is technical. Certainly quite a few changes that will help your organization be more efficient can completely be about governance and about policy. And again, I'll plug that tomorrow I'm talking a little more in depth about immutable infrastructure and how you could make your Drupal instance suitable for running in AWS or in Docker. So yeah. More specifically, MLS addressed the outdated front-end UI by having a consistent MP7 theme that was sub-themed by all the different clubs and skin to keep a consistent design language and to work and responsive. Giving club editorial teams kind of a couple more tools to work with, but still very carefully making sure that that all still fits into that responsive platform. Getting to the point where MLS was doing auto-scaling so that they could automatically scale up and not worry so much about spiky traffic, and also help to lower their overall hosting bill by using those kinds of services. Still in process, but trying to get to a point where there is really kind of just one technology stack. Like there's always going to be, I think, at least in the near term, there's going to be Drupal as the main CMS and JavaScript, whether in the browser or on the server, as the main component to all the other services part of the platform, but trying to move towards a kind of coming together of deployment strategies. And you know, in the end, we actually managed to get all 21 of those websites live on Drupal and in Amazon Web Services.
So what the future looks like for us. 2015 is really just about getting to D7, getting in the cloud, and we did it. 2016, it's about making, for, performance is always going to be a goal, in my opinion, but yes, increasing performance, but now focusing on the editorial usability of that, you know, of that migration, and really looking at all of the modules, the forms, the editorial experience, and how we can facilitate them to tell the stories they want to tell and not feel so confined by the tools that are at their disposal. So that, this is a major focus. And you know, as I keep mentioning, the consolidation and simplification of the tech stack is important to me. Now, just to clarify, what I mean is by this is every problem has a tool that is best suited for it. And by no means do we want to have like one language and one platform, but we do want to see what, you know, use the right tool for the right problem. So in terms of content management, Drupal is the right tool. In terms of video ingestion and data ingestion, we were happy with both Node and Go. But in terms of deployment, there really should be only one technology for that. In terms of configuration management, the same thing. And consolidating here is where we started, and we're continuing to work on. And this is going to have pretty big organizational impact, as it allows us to continue to be light, nimble, and get a lot done with very little. And actually, Docker as a sub note there is kind of one of the crucial technologies that's enabling that. And finally, preparing for omnichannel. Omnichannel is major for us. Like I mentioned before, the desktop is just one of the many products that our users consume our content on. So we have to make sure that everything from our content model to our distribution of that content is really optimized for the consumption on any form factor, whether it be connected television or a chatbot. You know, whatever it is, we want to make sure that we have the ability to get our content to that device, to the right channel at the right time, at the right moment for that user. And you can check us out at we've got a technology blog where we constantly talk about the new tools we're using, what's working for us at labs.mlssoccer.com, the league site, and you can visit Phase2 at phase2technology.com.
Thank you.
Questions? None?
So if you have a question, please go to that mic and turn it on. You just want to walk up to the mic and ask the question.
Yeah, you might have to turn it on too.
Is that working?
Uh-oh. If it's not working, I can just repeat it for the recording.
Here, how about that? Is that coming through?
Yeah. I think so, yeah.
Well, I was just curious, as you talk about the future and omnichannel, you also talk about delivery to alternate devices, Internet of Things, you got stadiums. Like, I was out at Avaya Stadium last year, and they're trying to make it like this whole digital experience of, you know, fan interaction. Talked about hyper-localization and stuff real-time, like delivering to different, you know, not kiosks and mega jumbotrons or whatever, you know, all that tracking, player tracking, fan tracking.
Well, definitely player tracking, definitely fan tracking would probably be the high priority of what you mentioned. In terms of IoT, I think that's something that's very interesting to us. However, before we can even get there, you definitely have to have the foundation and the pipeline to transmit information to said devices. With respect to the stadiums, our product directors in the back there, he can speak more to that. But really, each club and each stadium kind of has its own little world, and they have their own sort of technologies that they're using. And so, back to the omnichannel. I mean, if we can provide consistent consistent access to our content, then that would enable anyone, whether it be the stadium or a partner, a content partner, to get our content. And there have been talks here and there to sort of integrate and augment the stadium experience, but nothing specific, and we don't have anything in the immediate plans. But in my opinion, it's really about getting our services to be quite performant and be fully robust and expose every kind of content we create through an API, and that will, I think, will set us up for things like that.
Cool.
Hey, of the 21 teams, were there any that were kind of special snowflakes, you know, and they had their own ideas about the creative direction and the platform and weren't really on board, and you had to kind of navigate that a little bit and bring them along? Or were they, everyone was sort of on the same page?
Wade, in the back. No? No? I will say this. So I think a consequence of having a difficult request for a service that you're providing is what are the capabilities in the said customer, right? So if they have technology staff, they're going to want things that are going to be difficult, right? As it happens, there is no real technology staff at any of our clubs currently at the moment, other than some mobile competency to create ancillary web apps for said club. Like Seattle has its own web app that's kind of its own thing, albeit it does use our API to consume its content. But because of that situation, we were able to move it lockstep and kind of roll out changes, and everyone kind of accepted it. I'll reiterate what Stephen mentioned. Having a centralized group, we call it DCS or Digital Club Services, but a centralized group of power users that are really the face of Drupal and really the tier one to technology is kind of crucial, because the whole time they're managing these changes and they're kind of communicating to our clubs and making them feel at ease about the changes one way or another, and that really does set us up to move in a multi-tenanted environment, which I think is kind of what you're getting to, because that's a problem with multi-tenanted, I know. Anything else?
Thanks for the presentation, and definitely thanks to MLS for sharing. You guys, I've seen you before at other DrupalCons, Drupal events, and it's been really very useful for our organization.
Great.
So my question is about multi-site. So when you push out a release and you have 20 sites running the same code base, and let's say there's a schema change, do you do anything special to handle the UpDBs and the feature reverts that brings them all down at the same time?
Yeah, this is Stephen's baby.
Yes, this is the maybe hidden or not so hidden downside of multi-sites is what happens when a contrib module like renames a field, let's say, because then you got a big problem, because if your old code before the schema update happens will work, and the new code will be like, this field's not in the database, crash. Then the same thing happens when you update the schema, and then the old code base will be like, oh, the old field's not in the database, crash. So what do you do? So when we initially designed this, I was a little bit lying. We didn't do this as a straight up multi-site out of the bat. We had one extra thing in place where during a deployment, we would deploy the old code base, the new code base, then we would do the scheme update and flip symlinks one by one. So that we could, like essentially we were still doing that deployment where we said, okay, and we do that on the editorial tier of servers, which are kind of pets. They're not autoscale, they're a separate group, because they're like, you know, behind a more restrictive firewall, only accessible to clubs. So in that case, we could actually do that, like flip the symlink, run the schema update, go flip, 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 and then actually make that live. So that certainly is a problem though, and you know, it would be nice if contrib was a little better about like, well, let's not just like rename a field, let's instead, you know, like change the semantics and maybe like provide a more graceful path. But you will occasionally still, that's probably the biggest downside of multi-site, is that you just have to look at your schema updates carefully. Because yeah, there's nothing that could stop a module from just being like, I'm gonna delete this field, and then the code will be like, I have a PDO error because I can't find this. So it is not perfect. I will say that like we have our stopgap solution there of being able to at least for the big scheme updates, like to run them and then like flip the new code base and run it on a site by site basis, and then like kind of let that, you know, catch up as we deploy the new AMIs out. But yeah, that's definitely the biggest thing, and I think that that's probably the thing where you have to kind of be the most careful.
Thanks. I also had one other question. You mentioned Docker, but it wasn't clear to me whether you're actually using it now or that's something you're moving toward. Can you just talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, so
yes and yes. We're using it now. Any new technology that we introduce to our stack is fully Dockerized. The only thing that is right now not Dockerized in production is Drupal, and we already have a Dockerized Drupal version ready, and we're just waiting to release it during some downtime. So, but everything like our the apps that run our Apple TV, our API, our ancillary websites, which provide stats, everything is Dockerized, and Drupal will be Dockerized very soon, and that we'll have everything Dockerized by the end of the year.
And actually, I'll throw a plug out for my favorite container scheduler, which is Kubernetes. MLS is using Kubernetes. We did quite a bit of work to kind of decide on that. And one of the biggest reasons for that is that MLS has a bunch of node apps, and node apps are great, except that they only use one CPU core, right? Because node is single-threaded. So there were several cases where node, where MLS had services that would take very high traffic, and eventually just at some traffic threshold, like one process would not be able to handle it. The cool thing with Kubernetes is that it has built-in kind of service discovery. So you can say, like, spin up a service that handles our WebSocket traffic, and then you can literally scale just that service. You can be like, oh, hey, we need to go from 5 pods to 20 pods. And that way you can, on the same physical machine, be running like 20 copies of a node app that can use, say, 20 cores of the machine, as opposed to like having to build in the node cluster module and do all this extra stuff. So it actually has an additional huge benefit for a lot of the node-based apps that MLS runs, kind of that Kubernetes like has service discovery built in and has load balancing based in, which then also means you have horizontal scaling baked in. Like you can just say, hey, we know it's going to be a high traffic day. Let's go ahead and just scale up to 20 of our WebSocket instances. And there is even in Kubernetes 1.2 like an experimental autoscaler for pods, like for containers themselves. You can say, like, if the average CPU of these containers is high, add a new one in. So that actually, I think, fits really nicely with some of the node-based services that MLS is running.
I wanted to know if you could tell us a little bit more about the video ingestion. You mentioned some of the tools you're using. Where are the sources for the video? Do they come from the editors? Do you have outside feeds? Sure. Do you allow fans to upload photos or video clips?
Great question. Okay, so we have two main sources of video. One is our live videos provided by a vendor, New Lion. Our encoding and our VOD video is housed in a video CMS and a service with Ooyala, so we don't use the alternative to Brightcove. So that's the two points where video assets would be introduced into the system. The way that the ingest works in a nutshell is we've got a series of microservices which is constantly polling these systems and syncing them down into Drupal and then also bidirectionally syncing them back. And it's this pipeline of microservices which allow us the ability to focus on on getting things from one system to another in localized ways so that if one thing breaks, not everything breaks. So the transcoding and the conversion is done with our video provider. So I know that there's a lot of people deal with their own they do their own encoding. We kind of go with in terms of build versus buy. If the vendor can do it and they do a decent job at doing it, let them keep doing it until there comes to a point in time where we do have to take it on ourselves. And at this point, we're not. So yeah, the encoding happens with Ooyala. Oh, and then in terms of UGC, we have integration with our Twitter, Vine, like everything Instagram, and that is integrated into our match experience, our match site called matchcenter.mls.com, and that is primarily where users are uploading content. So we don't use Drupal for UGC, we use social platforms. All right, anything else? All right, thanks guys.
All right, and then I think I'm contractually obligated to say that if you go to the session page, you can leave comments or questions and let us know how we did. And again, thanks for coming to our session.
Sure.